Don't try to sneak into your room like that. I know what you've got behind your back. Records. More new records.
It's the first question, I guess, that Jeff and all of us talked about was why. You know, why? It's the same with the number ones. Actually, the number ones was you know, Jeff mentioned it, but so will you look at remixing number ones? I was like, why? We're gonna do a 5-1 for the videos. It's like okay, you can only do a 5-1 by remixing. So we remixed it, and the pathway to mixing the ones, I realized that it'd be great if we could get the vocals in the center, and so they're more like, you know, the band kind of designed stuff in mono, and it'd be great if we do that. And we started opening these doors, and then I thought, well, we'll get away with this, and hopefully they won't be released on CD, and then they're released on CD, and you think, oh no, and then people liked it. And I was like, great, got away with that one as well. You know, after Love, I thought it'd be firebombed, and I managed to still be alive. And the reason why with Pepper, Sergeant Peppers is to look at the mix processes, because when the band recorded it with my father and with Jeff Emmerich all those years ago, they labored over it and they opened so many doors, but it was designed for mono. They mixed it in mono. They spent a lot of time mixing the monos. The band were present and they had their fingers in the faders and they had demands on how the album should sound. And then when it came to the stereos, the band were off, you know, probably running a Magical Mystery Tour or All You Need Is Love, or you know, they'd probably been in the room and know exactly what they were doing. But they weren't present, and so the stereos were kind of a throwaway.
And I'll give you examples of the differences. I mean, I think John Lennon said you haven't heard Sgt. Pepper unless you heard it in mono. Now, we can't expect people today to listen to the monos, and so our new mix is an homage to them, to their ideas, and to what they did. This is where things get tricky, because I'm about to use this and my laptop and everything at the same time. So there are vast differences between how the mono was dealt with and the stereo was dealt with. I'll play some examples. So I shall switch microphones, there we are. So She's Leaving Home, for instance. The record that's out now, the stereo record that's out now, is this. Beautiful, sorry, this is beautiful. But it's not what Paul wanted. And in the mono, sounds like this. It's very spare, the tape machine is very spare, the 7-turn up. So now when we come to mixing the stereo, it's kind of crazy. I mean, that's a big difference. That's a big difference. The band saying this is what we want it to be, and the stereo is vastly different. And the other thing, this is why I need two microphones. My neck's gonna go weird. I'll pick up. We got pros in on me. The other thing is that we have this benefit now with technology. From where we did Love, we have this benefit from going to the earlier version of the 4-track. So if you imagine that the Beatles recorded on 4-tracks, or Sgt. Pepper's recorded on 1-inch 4-track tape, so you can have 4 things on one tape. And with the ambition of Sgt. Pepper, that wasn't enough. And so they would bounce those 4 tracks down to 1 track by the next 4-track tape, and so on and so forth. So when they came to doing the final mix, they mixed from the final 4-track, which sometimes is bounced down 3 times, which means you don't need choices. You've already made your choices on the line. And also, if anyone is old enough in the room, which there are some people who are old enough in the room, just a few. You certainly. So well done. I'm surprised you're not seeing everything in black and white. No. It means there's degradation between generations of tape. So we're mixing off tapes, which are the band being recorded, which have never actually, the band didn't mix off. They bounce down from them, which means you get a completely different dynamic. And actually it creates two things. You get a much more of a dynamic and much better clarity, which we're not adding, it's there already. But also it gives us choices. So if I play you, lovely Vita. I'm switching microphones again, by the way, just so you know. Quick. If I play lovely Vita, on the stereo, because the rhythm track can be bounced down to one track and then bounced over tape, it's just on the left hand side. I'll play it. And you'll notice there's also a lot more kick drum in there. It's just because we're taking Ringo as Ringo and not Ringo's second generation, if that makes sense. So we can do stuff, but really what we're trying to do here. What we're trying to do here. That's me again. What we're trying to do here is there are notes in the tape boxes and we can listen to the monos. We have the benefit of hindsight. And we can kind of, we're doing it, you know, myself and Sam O'Kell, as the engineer, we're doing it to try and pay homage to my father, to Jeff Emmerich, and especially the band, is what they wanted. That's what we think about. We kind of pretend that they're there, if that makes sense. And we also try and push things as much as we can. I'll give you one last example of this. When the mono was done, because the band were there and because it's just one track, you could do more, put more effects on it. And John loved changing his voice. In fact, Sgt. Pepper, Lonely Hearts Club Band's album, has lots of different vocal changes. The bands that are playing around with various speed, different pitches. And with Lucy and the Sky with Diamonds, they use something called ADT, which is artificial double tracking, where you put a signal through a tape machine and record it back, so you end up with two signals, which you can vary speed, which you can change the pitch on. I play the mono Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. His voice has this really beautiful quality to it. It's kind of like screwed up. I'll tell you how good I am. I'm doing a demonstration of John's voice, and I play our mix when Paul starts singing, which means that, you know, I'm really qualified. But when I do play the so the new mix essentially is you know the you know learning from my father and you know working you know for Apple and the band is that they want us to push things as much as we can, but it's all about getting the feel of that original mono that they made and make it a stereo. On top of this, as Jeff mentioned, you know, the impetus and actually the excitement for a lot of people was extras, finding alternate takes. And I don't know if that's more challenging than mixing, because you're releasing or thinking about stuff that I suppose my father and the band, you know, they didn't release, and I've got to make a decision. But actually, what we what we did is think about how is Sgt. Pepper made, and it's made from the four boys in the studios making sound together. There's no sort of ethereal greatness plucked from a cloud. It's purely, it's 24, 25-year-olds making noise in the studios. And I think that's an incredible thing. It's not about, the magic is in their personality and their ability, not in some sort of ethereal buttons pressed. And I want to play you, I'll play you Fixing a Hole, which I've got a story, which it's funny, it's because I did this morning, but I felt like I'm getting boring and repeating myself. But Fixing a Hole, I went down to go and play the mixes to Paul and go through the mixes with him, because, you know, if he doesn't like them, then you don't get to hear them. Fixing a Hole, they didn't actually, it was the first time the band went out of Abbey Road and they recorded a place called Regent Sound, because Abbey Road was busy, and they went to Regent Sound Studios. And Paul told me he got a knock at the door, and he opened the door, and there was a guy there, and he goes, "Hello, I'm Jesus." And Paul went, "Oh, this is his house." And Paul went, "Oh, you better come in there." Not thinking this kid was a loony, but he invited me and made Jesus a cup of tea. And they said, "You know, I'm going to go down to Soho to make a record. Do you want to come with me, Jesus?" And Jesus said yes. And he drove him down and he walked to the studio and goes, "Hey lads, you know, this is Jesus. He's going to be in the session with us." And he sat in the room and they recorded Fixing a Hole. And they recorded it in three takes. And for take one is the take that's on the record. And what they did is they took take one and they went back to Abbey Road, and actually they basically played everything again. So Fixing a Hole has three basses on it. So they overlay and overlay. But this is take three, and there's the warm-up here in the studios. You can't hear Jesus. I think he remained quiet when they were recording, as is the dignified manner of any deity. So here we are. So what that kind of shows is it's them making the sounds. Do you know what I mean? That each song sounded different on Pepper, which creates that journey. But it's them making the sounds. It's kind of cool that you think of the ages they are, and you think, my father was a large part of this because he worked as a sort of satellite dish for their ideas, if you like. He never said no, and if they said they wanted to do something, even if it was John saying, "Can you make it orange?" he would try and make it orange.
Did John say that?
Apparently John did say that too. It's not time for questions. No, apparently he did say that. He said that I'm the walrus, apparently. Which I probably got that wrong. I'm probably going to rest a minute. But yeah. I'll play another little nugget of... I'll play two things, actually, just quickly. I won't play them in total. the construction of, so the final chord on the record of A Day in the Life is not, was not completed until later. They had the orchestral crescendo, and then they thought about what they're going to do at the end. What they did, they put the piano chord on it. What they tried to do first time around is actually they thought about this chorus E chord, which they decided not to do, and you'll understand why I'm going to play it to you.
A Day in the Life, this is take 8 and it's required for the end.
Eight
beats then, just like count 8. As soon as you say, right, just stop.
What's the note?
And it'll show you just on the check. 1, 2, 3, 4.
In stereo, yeah, that's, yeah. I still hate CDs, I will never like CDs.